Please join us in Philippians chapter 2. Again, we're in verse 8. In verse 8, we actually find four of the seven steps down that Jesus took to minister to us. I'm going to repeat all seven that happened in verse 7 and 8 so that you are up to date. And here we are in the sixth step down. The first step down begins in Philippians chapter 2, verse 7. Begins saying this, but made himself, number one, of no reputation. Number two, taking the form of a bondservant, a slave. Number three, coming in the likeness of men. Number four, into verse 8, and being found in the appearance as a man. Number five, he humbled himself. And number six, became obedient to death. Number seven will be next week, and Pastor Connor will be covering not only step seven, but also summarizing these two powerful verses, which really have given us a pretty clear understanding of the mindset, the kind of mind that the Spirit of God wants us to have. And I think that's particularly important in these last days. Particularly important in these last days. So step number six then is found in verse 8, obedient to death. Some of your verses, some of your Bibles will say obedient to the point of death. However, the point of are not found in the more recent, more ancient discoveries with respect to the New Testament. So those words are either italicized in your Bible, or should be, or actually are removed. So, in essence, and more literally in the Greek, it means obedient to death. Now, to be obedient is something that we as a church have learned a lot about, particularly in our community groups when we talked about the Shema, O Israel, which means hear and obey. Hear and obey. Shema, O Israel, means the nation of Israel, every Jew, calls upon themselves every morning and every evening before bed to hear the word of God, hear the God of the word, and also commit themselves to be obedient. Now, if Jesus was like us, he likely wouldn't have been obedient even to the point of death, because we're looking at, in a sense, a commitment a cause that Jesus recognizes only he can fix this eternal problem. Only Jesus can fix this eternal problem. Yeah. We begin this morning by just taking another look at probably one of the most famous verses in the New Testament in John chapter 3, verse 16, where Jesus is telling us through John, for in this way God loved the world, so that he gave his one and only Son, in order that everyone who believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life. So the Father's mission was to give his Son. And not, that doesn't mean just inject him in the likeness of man, or in the appearance of man, or in a humble manner, because there have been many men and women who in very humble attitude have lived on this earth, particularly as Christians, and you might also say in an Old Testament sense, as Jews. So the issue isn't just looking for someone who lived a life as a Jew or as a Christian, who was a man, clearly a human being, came in the appearance that was dictated or prophesied hundreds of years before him, but was beyond that also, humble to the point, or had this mind in him, that this commitment to you that are called in John 3:16, God loved the world. You are part of the world. That the Father determined, I'm going to give my only begotten Son. And that's the Shema says that. That hear, O Israel, your God is one, and he alone is God. So it's very important for Jews to think in terms of two important comments with regard to our Father in heaven. He alone is God, and he is but one God. So that in the Shema is repeated every morning and every evening. Jesus humbled himself, and this lends to here the sixth step, because Jesus determined to humble himself in obedience unto death. Charles Haddon Spurgeon says this with respect to that. He says our text does not speak so much of the humiliation of Christ in becoming man as of his humiliation after he took upon himself our nature. He had not descended low enough, though he had come down all the way from the Godhead to our manhood. What will not Christ do for us who have been given to him by his Father? There is no measure to his love, and that's important in remembering as we move on this morning. There is no measure to his love. You cannot comprehend his grace. Oh, how we ought to love him and serve him. The lower he stoops to save us, the higher we ought to lift him in our adoring reverence. Blessed be his name. He stoops and stoops and stoops, and when he has reached our level and become man, he still stoops and stoops lower and deeper yet. His struggle is so obvious in Gethsemane. We're so well aware, and we typically rehearse this in the days surrounding the Resurrection Sunday and the Passover season. And we think concerning Jesus not so much struggling with the Father's will, because in the end he says, even so, not my will be done, but your will be done. What an important thing for each of us to say on a daily basis. But understanding that, as it says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21, that our Father made the one who did not know sin to be sin on our behalf. There is the crushing blow of Gethsemane. Understanding the huge capacity of sin, our sin, that will be laid upon him who has never carried the burden of sin. Never been under the great worrisome burden of sin. And Jesus said to his disciples, Matthew 11, 28, come unto me. Here, disciples, come to me, you who are weary and heavy laden. Heavy laden with what? Weary with what? Sin. And Jesus is now understanding that on that Thursday night, he's about to be arrested and brought to a horrifying death. Jesus has determined, I will be obedient. I will be obedient to the mission of my Father, who is about to make me, who knows no sin, the absolute culmination of all sin that has ever occurred. And he weeps. And he asks his disciples, please pray with me. Sweet hour of prayer, please pray with me. And he realizes in conclusion that though their spirit was willing, their flesh was so weak. To die for someone else. It's not a foreign concept. In fact, anybody in our military who has ever gone to war in any foreign theater understands that in signing and raising their hand and committing themselves to the United States military means that it is very possible. Some arms of the military, actually even probable, that you will give your life for the Constitution, for the way of American life, to bring peace, to keep peace. But what about you and I? Are we as Christians called, much less committed, to dying for someone else? It indeed is the ultimate measure of commitment, of dedication, of devotion. You might say it's the ultimate description of love. Love surpasses the boundary of my life in committing it to your success. We've talked about that last Sunday. We gave breadth and length to the idea of being humble, and that we're called to humble ourselves, not to humble others. I'm not your Holy Spirit, neither is your wife or your husband, neither is your boss. The Holy Spirit is, guess what? The Holy Spirit. And when He humbles us, we must be prepared to respond to that humbling factor. Because in a sense, I think that if we refuse to humble ourselves, He wants to pour grace out on us. Oh, how He wants to give grace over and over and over. But the Word says in James and in Peter that He resists the proud but gives grace to the humble. Oh, how much more I want to be humble and say, Father, even so, let Your will be done. It is interesting that in Ephesians chapter 5, husbands are actually commanded by the Holy Spirit through Paul to commit their lives in dedication to giving them that life up for the purpose of protecting and saving their wife. Let me read Ephesians 5, starting in verse 25. For husbands, this means love your wives. Just as Christ loved the church, He gave up His life for her. We're Christians because we understand in a very personal way what the death of Christ on the cross, but even more importantly, His resurrection means to each of us, because it was His blood that washed us from all our wrongdoing, has set us free, has removed the weary, burdensome life of sin, has given us power to overcome addiction and fear. He gave up His life for her, verse 26, to make her holy and clean. Now, wait a second. If we are connecting the dots here in Ephesians 5, verse 25 and 26, we're realizing that Jesus gave up His life for the church of Jesus Christ. And what has He done with her? With the washing of the water of God's Word, He is cleansing her and purifying her. This means that the church of Jesus Christ is in need of cleansing and purifying. But husbands, we're to be doing the same thing. To commit our lives to our wives, to say, I would give my life for you. And I'm committed also in my household to continue to wash my wife with the water of God's Word, to wash my children, to debrief my children on a daily basis, to care enough for them. As every parent knows, being a parent means sacrifice. It means there may even be times when parents don't eat so that their children can. And if you've ever been there, it's a humbling situation. Verse 27 of Ephesians 5, He did this to present her to Himself as a glorious church without a spot or wrinkle or any other blemish. Instead, she will be holy and without fault. And that's how the Father sees His church this morning. He sees you as Christians, followers of Christ, engaged in the community of believers this morning. He is washing you with the water of God's Word so that He can present you to Himself without spot and without blemish. Now, husbands are told to do this for their wives as well. Now, that's interesting because I wonder how many husbands would really consider dying for their wife. Let that kind of churn in your mind for a second. Well, of course, in the midst of the body of Christ, you would be ready to admit, I'd give my life for my wife right now. Really? Oh, is that right? Now, we don't face those issues, for the most part, in America. There are many countries in this world where entire families, for instance, the Coptic Christians in Egypt, who are often crucified in front of the husband, the father, for the purpose of his recanting his faith in Jesus Christ. And when he refuses to, then he's crucified upside down as well. Who endures such things? Who can even fathom such horrifying things like that? But yet they happen in this world. Not so much in America. I wonder, husbands, think in terms of being Jesus right now. And would you die for your wife if she was an adulterer? Would you stand in front of a bus if she was a floozy drunk? If she had children in adultery? If she in fact hated you and Christ, becoming a devout atheist in the course of your marriage? What if she went out and gambled your life savings at Chumash? There's been plenty of people that have done that. Still ready to give your life for her? Well, you put it in those terms, Pastor, then, you know, honestly, how many husbands would do that? And yet, in the filth of your sin, Jesus died for you. The story of Hosea is one that is unique in the Old Testament, and it seems to be encapsulated and made very powerful in the New Testament of Romans chapter 5. But Hosea is called on by the Father to marry a wife, Gomer, of adultery, knowing that during that marriage she would have three children of adultery, and their names would be names Lo Ami, Lo Ruhama, Jezreel, names that would resound in the nation of Israel, of God saying to Israel, you have played the harlot with me. But it's a story of powerful redemption as well. In Hosea chapter 3, when Hosea discovers that his wife, who's had three children in adultery, has left him for prostitution, is now coming up on the marketplace to be sold as a slave. Hosea chapter 3 in the first three verses tells us what happens on that day when Hosea goes into the city and begins to bid for his wife. Now, ancient records of history tell us a lot about the manner in which female slaves would be bought and sold. And I won't go into the, because we've got families out here, but your imagination can probably nail it down pretty good for you. We pick it up in Hosea chapter 3, verse 1, and Yahweh said to me again, to Hosea, go love a woman who has had a lover and is right now committing adultery. Just like the love of Yahweh for the children of Israel, but they are turning to other gods and love the raisin cakes. Now, no Nazirite would ever let a raisin touch his lips. So priests never ate raisins. The raisin cakes were those cakes that were offered to idols and pagan gods. And here's the woman that is making a livelihood from prostitution and loving the idols' worship and the pagans' refuse. So I bought her, verse 2 of Hosea 3, I bought her for 15 shekels of silver and a homer, a basket of barley, and a measure of wine. Because we know a lot about the history of slave markets, 15 shekels of silver was about half price for his wife. It could speak to two things. It could speak to the fact that that's all he had, and that's what many would suggest with respect to not only the silver, but also bringing every food article from his home as well, including his wine. Could also speak to the respect of a woman that was well spent, and no one else was bidding on it. And so he purchases her from the market of the city, and I said to her, Hosea says to his wife, you must remain as mine for many days, and you will not play the whore. You will not belong to a man, and I will belong to you. It's a testimony of God's faithfulness to us, even when we play the harlot, even when our interests. Our worship is divided among perhaps the things of this world, or the things of our flesh, or the course of this world, or the devil himself. And Christians have this wrong mindset with respect to our Savior, who has offered his blood, not for some of your sins, but for all of your sins. Not for some of your stinky attitudes, but for all of your stinky attitudes. And here's why where I want you to turn to Romans chapter 5. And we're going to look at three important things in verses 6 through 10 that lend directly to Jesus being obedient to death. Paul's writing in his letter to the church of Rome, writing to them as a fellow slave. He introduces himself in that manner in the first verse of the first chapter. But now, by chapter 5, he's beginning to parse, as it were, some deep theological issues that will waken the Jews that were also slaves in Rome. And here, Paul says this with respect to their life, and by the way, is saying this to you with respect to your life. Romans chapter 5, verse 6. For while we were still helpless, okay, in a position of absolute helplessness, couldn't do anything for ourselves whatsoever, couldn't solve the problem of sin in our debt, in our weariness. While we were still helpless, you might circle the first half of verse 6, yet at the proper time Christ died for the ungodly. He died for you when you were in your most helpless state, not when you were your strongest, when you think perhaps, oh, look at how I'm doing, God. Yeah, of course you want to die for me. No, he died for you when you were your most helpless. We move on to verse 7. And this is where it connects to Philippians chapter 2, verse 8. For only rarely will someone die on behalf of a righteous person. Enough said there, right? I mean, if you knew a righteous person and you were asked to die for them, you might really strongly contemplate that, because they deserve for someone to die for them. But Paul says it actually is pretty rare that someone would extend their dedication to another person to that extent. For on behalf of a good person, possibly someone might even dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us. Here's my second point, verse 8. In that while we were still sinners, which means in its verbiage that we were in the midst of a sin when Jesus had you on his mind and gave his life. Having never committed sin, he took upon himself the sin that you were in the midst of sinning, and he demonstrated his love toward you. Now that's love. That's dedication. Obedience to death. Why? Because he had your sin on his heart and mind. And he's not dying a death every week. We don't picture him through these symbols of communion as of actually becoming the body of Christ or becoming the blood of Jesus. It wasn't in the Passover meal, it isn't this morning either. They are symbols. Symbols as Jesus applied them to us as his church. But God, verse 8, demonstrated his own love for us in that while we were in the midst of our sin, note verse 7 as it concludes, Christ died for us. You didn't need to clean yourself up. You didn't need to put on your Sunday best. You didn't need to stop cursing for a half an hour. You didn't even need to walk home from Elmer's. Jesus died for you when you were in the depth and the breadth and the pinnacle of your sin. And by the way, verse 6, when you were most helpless. Verse 9 through 10. Therefore, by much more, because we have been declared righteous now by his blood, we will be saved through him from the wrath. And here's my third point in Romans chapter 5, verses 6 through 10. For if we, while we were enemies. You see that? So you should have three circles in verses 6 through 10. First circle is in verse 6 as it begins, while we were still helpless. And then in verse 8, while we were still sinners. And then in verse 10, while we were enemies. Directly and vehemently opposed to Christ. Jesus gave his life for you. It wasn't when you finally discovered what it meant in a religious manner to obey him by genuflecting or whatever it is, giving. You know, there's so many mechanisms by which men think they can engender or encourage God to like them if they do certain things. Oftentimes the church would use the concept of penance. There is but one penance for the sin of mankind, the blood of Jesus Christ. You cannot pay in any manner and in any form anything to engender the love of Christ, the love of our Father, outside the sacrifice of Jesus, our Savior. We were enemies. We were in the midst of our sin. We were ultimately entirely helpless. And what does it tell us? Over and over and over, Christ died for us when we were our most unrighteous, when we were the most unlikely to engender the favor of any human being. No one would die for you. You're a stinking maniac. You're a sinning whatever. Die for someone who's a harlot, who's an adulterer, who's a drunk, a flender. You can begin to add all manner of things. No, you wouldn't do that because you would value your life above theirs. Isn't that what you would decide? But rather, Jesus values your life above his own. You are more important to live eternally than for his frail human life on this earth. So the vessel of purity that God sent to his earth, why? Because he loved you so much. This vessel of purity, containing as it were such holiness that his conversations with his Father were never impeded by the weight of sin, oftentimes these stinky attitudes that we have because we are still sinners. And he gave all that up. No wonder from the cross he said, my God, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani, why have you forsaken me? Because when he became your sin, not sin just in some ethereal, you know, obtuse sense, when he became your sin, when he became your sin, when he became my sin, the Father, for the first time in eternity past, stepped aside from looking upon his Son and all of his adoration, and he saw despicable, horrifying, putrid, wretched sin. And when Jesus breathed his last, into thy hands I commit my spirit, and he breathed his last. Don't we in fact all pray that our spirit would be committed to him? Some are gambling on their deathbed that, oh, there, I'll become a Christian there. And in some cases, I hear stories of that actually working. But I'm not a gambler.
No, sir.
And by the way, when I try to be, I'm the absolute worst. You know?
Yeah.
I might as well just drive by Chumash and start lighting $100 bills and throwing them out the window. There you go. That was fun. People chalk it off for entertainment. Baloney. You are feeding a devouring lion that will never be satisfied with what you can give them in your pocket. They want everything. They want everything you have. Oh, but I just go to the buffets. You are still feeding the lion. The word obedient means to give ear to, and that's where the connection is to the Shema, O Israel. Jesus heard the directive of his Father. He knew what that meant in the Garden of Gethsemane, and he recommitted his obedience to the Father. But by the way, aren't you glad that he did?
Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
I would not be here except that Jesus, finding me in a helpless state, finding me in the midst of my sin, finding me when I had called him my enemy. I don't know if you know this, but I was engaged to another girl about almost six or eight months before I met Lucy. And on the Christmas before I met Lucy, I stood with her on the beach of Fort Myers in Florida, and we shook our hands. I don't know why, but it's a bell in my heart. We shook our fists on the rising sun, and we said we would never, ever be Christians. That's worth an alarm. Hallelujah. It is. And it's an alarm that has rung in my heart ever since, because I recognize it's though the Father from heaven looked down upon me and said, "Oh, Paul, you have no idea what I have for you, but not in your helpless estate, not in the midst of your sin, not as an enemy. I'm about to do something in your life that will bring you to strength rather than helplessness. I will bring you to a life of power and glory in the blood of Jesus, and you will never again be an enemy." How about you this morning? Does that somehow speak into your life? Because you see, if you go to your death as an enemy, to your death as helpless, to your death in the midst of your sin, you see, you have no recompense. Oh, but I helped an old lady cross the street. Oh, but I prayed at meals. Oh, but I own this huge Bible on our coffee table. Doesn't that mean anything? I got a plastic dash on my statue on my dash. I got a bumper sticker that says, "Wise men still seek him." Nothing, and the Lord will say, "Nothing. Nothing. You're still helpless. You're still in the midst of your sin. You are still calling me your enemy." Let's make Jesus our friend this morning. Let's pray as we come to our time of communion. Let's pray now to invite Jesus into your heart, because he longs to do just that. Because this is why he came. This is why he gave his life. To draw you to him. To wash you in the power of his blood. To remove from you the weariness and burdensomeness of your sin. And to set you free. To set you free. Hallelujah.